Akbar, Jalaluddin Muhammad Akbar, was born in 1542 CE in Amarkot when his father Humayun was in exile. He accompanied his father and mother Hamida Banu Begum to Kabul, where he was left behind, and his parents went off to Persia. When his father returned to India, he came with him. Prince Akbar's tutor was Mullah Sada, although he never learned to read and write. He enjoyed hearing others read out to him. He showed great fondness for animals and devoted a lot of time to dogs, horses, camels and pigeons. He also enjoyed painting. At the age of 13, he was appointed as governor of Punjab, but he did not trouble himself much with state affairs. He occupied himself in shooting and hunting. We get valuable information about Akbar's reign from books. One of the Navratnas of Akbar, Abul Fazl, wrote Akbarnama, of which Aini Akbari is a part. Akbarnama literally means history about Akbar, which is a biography of Akbar. It is the most comprehensive history of the reign of Akbar. While Akbarnama is technically a history book, Aini Akbari is an administrative manual and is like a modern gazetteer. The regulations embodied in the Aini Akbari provide information about Akbar's government, its several departments, its different ranks, etc. There was another court historian, Badoni, who was highly critical of Akbar's policies. The painting here shows Abul Fazl presenting the Akbarnama to Akbar. Consolidation and expansion of empire. In 1556 CE, Hemu, the chief minister and general of Ali Shah, occupied Delhi and declared himself the ruler. Akbar and his enemy, under the guidance of his regent Bairam Khan, met the Afghan forces on the historic battlefield of Panipat. Hemu was defeated and killed. Thus, the Afghan power was crushed. This significant event is known in history as the Second Battle of Panipat. After winning this battle, Akbar reoccupied Delhi and Agra. Jaunpur, Ajmer, Agra and Gwalior also came under Mughal control. In 1561, Akbar conquered Malwa and defeated its king. His policy towards the Rajputs was to win them over by marriage alliances and by befriending them. He himself married the princes of Amber, Jodha Bai. Except Rana Pratap of Mewar, he made alliances with Rajput states of Amber, Bikaner, Ranthambore, Kalinjar and Jaisalmer. A battle was also fought between Mughals and the forces of Mewar. The fort of Chittor was captured and the troops of Rana Pratap were defeated at the Battle of Haldi Ghati. But Mewar did not surrender to Mughal control. The Rajput policy of Akbar helped him to secure Delhi and Agra and helped him to consolidate his territories. It also helped him to enlist the services of brave Rajput rulers who were given important posts in administration. In 1578, Gujarat was conquered and the ports of Gujarat meant more revenue through trade. Bengal was also annexed later and its seaports encouraged trade with Southeast Asia. The rich and fertile land of Bengal brought a lot of revenue for the emperor. Akbar also conquered Kabul, Kandahar, Kashmir and Balochistan, which increased trade between India, Persia and Central Asia. Akbar's Deccan policy. Akbar's ambition to rule over the whole Indian subcontinent and the prosperous economy of the south inspired him to venture into the Deccan. The mutual conflicts among the rulers in Deccan provided a favorable opportunity to Akbar to fulfill his dreams. Thus, the Mughal troops made their first appearance in the Deccan. Khandesh, Ahmednagar and Berar became Mughal provinces. The annexation of Gujarat provided the empire with additional revenue from the area's rich commercial centers, access to the Gulf of Cambay and hence to the holy city of Mecca and Medina in Arabian Peninsula. So, Akbar's vast empire extended from Hindu Kush in the west to Brahmaputra in the east and from the Himalayas in the north to the Godavari in the south. Administration. Akbar worked out an efficient system of administration as the emperor was very powerful. All powers were concentrated in his hands. His interpretation of Islamic laws led to the decline of the position of ulemas. The emperor ruled with the help of council of ministers. The prime minister was also called wazir or diwan and was the head of the revenue department. Qazi was the chief justice and Mir Bakshi was in charge of the military administration. Diwan-i-Aam was the people's court where Akbar met common people. Diwan-i-Khas was the court for nobility and royalty where his officials and ministers could meet and discuss issues. The empire was divided into provinces or suba, which were further divided and subdivided into sarkars and parganas. A pargana consisted of many villages. The sabha was under a subedar, who was a provincial governor. He was helped by officers like the diwan, who kept the revenue records, and bakshi, who looked after the law and order situation. Army. The king had his own standing army, which was recruited by him. He followed the practice of branding horses to avoid corruption. His artillery was well organized and he also had cavalry and elephantry in his army. Mansabdari system was introduced in Akbar's army. Every officer was given a mansab or rank and was called a mansabdar. Soldiers were supplied by mansabdars, which was a title in the military of Mughal Empire. He had to maintain a fixed number of troops as per his rank to be supplied to the king. He was paid handsomely to take care of his expenses. A mansabdar could be transferred from one place to another. Revenue was an integral part of Akbar's administration. The main source of income for the state were land revenue and trade. Raja Todarmal, the finance minister, and one of the Navratnas introduced some measures to generate more land revenue. Land was properly measured and average produce was calculated on the basis of previous 10 years. One third of the revenue was fixed for the state. In case of drought or floods, land revenue was often waived off by the king. Trade was another source of income. The main items of export were textiles, spices, indigo, and saltpeter. Goods were traded with Central Asia, Southeast Asia, and Russia. Portuguese also established trade centers in the west coast of India. Akbar encouraged internal trade through the building of roads. Akbar's religious policy. Akbar had a secular outlook and a very liberal and tolerant attitude towards other religions. Akbar took several steps which appealed to Hindus, as they were in majority among his subjects. He abolished jizya, which was a tax paid by non-Muslims to a Muslim king. Rajput princesses were allowed freedom of worship. Pilgrimage tax was abolished. Mansabs were given to deserving Hindus like Raja Todarmal and Raja Man Singh. In employment, no discrimination was made on the basis of religion. Akbar had been brought up in an atmosphere of liberal ideas. He treated people of all religious faith of society equally, as he believed in sulkul or peace for all. He gradually realized that all religions had a number of good points. He built a hall of worship called Ibadat Khana, where he invited Muslim scholars to discuss issues involving their religion. However, Akbar was very disturbed with the narrow-mindedness of his ulemas, who disliked his policies and tried to control administration by supporting the groups that were against Akbar. Soon, Akbar invited scholars of all religions to hold discussion with them. In fact, he was seeking truth through the study of various religious beliefs. In 1582 CE, Akbar promulgated a new religious order called Din-e-Ilahi. Most leading nobles refused to join this religious order and Birbal was the only Hindu who joined it. As part of Sulkul, Akbar celebrated Navroz, the Parsi New Year, stopped cow slaughter and took to vegetarianism. He also got various holy books translated into Persian. Although he never learned how to read and write, yet he possessed good memory to remember accurately the contents of books read to him. Architecture. Akbar had set his new capital at Fatehpur Sikri, built of red sandstone. Fatehpur Sikri was chosen for capital as it was the birthplace of Salim Chishti, a Sufi saint for whom Akbar had great respect. Some other important buildings were Panch Mahal, Rani Jodhabai's palace, Diwan-e-Khas, etc. The architecture was a mix of Indian, Central Asian and Persian styles. The Buland Darwaza at Fatehpur Sikri was added to commemorate Akbar's victory over Gujarat. Humayun's tomb at New Delhi is another example of architecture of that period. It was enclosed in a garden and has a big gateway. Akbar's tomb at Sikandra, which was started by Akbar himself, was a huge structure without a tomb.